Hi everyone, greetings from Norway, and thanks to Edgar and Jim for putting together this event, and also apologies for my delay in uploading my presentation. My topic is Hegel on social kinds and teleological explanations. And I will begin with some general points about how I understand Hegel's metaphysics. I think that on Hegel's view, reality is articulated by objective kinds, which he calls concepts. Concept in an objective sense, not just concept in the sense of an entity in our thought. Here's one favorite passage which points in this direction. The nature, the peculiar essence, that which is genuinely permanent and substantial in the complexity and contingency of appearance and fleeting manifestation, is the concept of the thing, the immanent universal. Each human being, though infinitely unique, is so primarily because he is a man, and each individual animal is such individual primarily because it is an animal. So, as I understand this passage, there are objective kinds like man, animal, also more specific biological kinds, and we can understand these kinds in the sense of natural kinds as they are debated more recently. The idea is here that there are kinds which constitute and articulate a real order of things. They are not just one of many different ways of classifying things, and then what way we should privilege is just a matter of our contingent interests. For Hegel, as I understand him, there's a kind of objective ordering of reality which consists of these kinds. These kinds can play many important philosophical roles for Hegel. So, for example, they support inductive inferences, and especially important for him, as I understand him, they support explanations. We can explain the concrete features of an object on the basis of the kind to which the object belongs. Importantly, however, the idea of kinds that are objective in the sense that they constitute a real ordering of things as opposed to contingent ways of classifying things leaves open the possibility that the objects which are thus ordered are man-made and in this sense perhaps not objective or mind independent. So human activity is needed possibly to create some of the objects which may be ordered in such objective kinds, including possibly social phenomena. So this is a possibility that I'll explore in this talk. And just to give some initial plausibility to the idea that there may be such objective orderings of man-made, for example, social phenomena, take capitalism or democracy as candidates for objective social kinds. Contrast such kinds with classifications that are completely contingent, for example, based on the average length of surnames in a given society. That would also be a criterion for classifying societies. But intuitively, kinds like capitalism and democracy are closer to the joints of reality of nature, if there is such a thing in the social sphere. They can do important explanatory work, for example, within social within theories in social science and political science. If I know that a given economy is capitalist rather than, for example, communist or a feudal system, this tells me a lot about this form of economy and allows to explain important features about this given economy. And something similar holds for democracy as a candidate social kind, whereas different average lengths of surnames of people in a given society, they won't allow me to explain much regarding the concrete features in the society. So this as an initial illustration, but then I think one can also exegetically argue that Hegel actually assumes that there are social kinds, objective social kinds. And One way of arguing for this is by looking at the terminology that Hegel uses in these contexts. And there one can show that key terms that are important for his metaphysics of objective kinds, the term concept, but also the terms idea and genus, he employs them for objective kinds, for example in biology, but also for objective kinds in the social sphere, such as the state, marriage as an institution, and also civil society. Here is an important distinction between two different kinds of kinds. General distinction to begin with, and then we will have to see how that applies to social kinds. I think that for Hegel there's an important difference between what we may call teleological kinds and non-teleological kinds. Teleological kinds are the kinds of kinds that we find, for example, in organic nature, such as biological kinds, but also in spirit, for example, psychological kinds, for example, types of mental processes or mental abilities, that would also be objective kinds on my reading. And they are teleological because there is the possibility of a difference between is and ought in such cases. For Hegel, as I understand him, in such cases, the membership in a kind defines a teleological standard that the given instance, in a way, attempts to live up to, but then it may also fail to do so. For example, there's a teleological standard that defines what a good tiger is, a tiger that properly realizes the standard of tigerhood. Then there can also be instances of tigers which, for example, have only three legs or have some disease and therefore don't quite live up to that teleological standard. By contrast, non-teleological kinds in inorganic nature, for example, kinds of chemical substances, they don't allow for this difference between is and ought. Here, kind membership directly, on my reading, determines the laws that govern instances of this kind. They directly determine the dispositional properties that characterize instances of this kind, for example, dispositions to interact in particular ways with other chemical substances in chemical reactions. And there's no room here for a failure to live up to a kind-dependent standard. So given this distinction, what kind of kind is a social kind? I think they are clearly teleological kinds for Hegel. And one reason for thinking so is that he sometimes explicitly uses an analogy between deficient instances of social kinds, for example, tyranny as a bad state, as he says, and on the other hand, defective organisms which fail to live up to their kind specific standard. Then he famously also uses teleological explanations for social and historical phenomena, specifically invisible hand explanations, where the idea is that the useful effects are not a matter of individual planning. They go beyond the things that that individual agency represents as a purpose. And that at least fits very well with the idea that such phenomena involve kinds which are social kinds, which are teleological kinds in this distinction. And then also his famous doctrine or infamous doctrine of the state as an organism, this analogy that he wants to use between the state and a biological organism that also points in this direction. It is true that he also uses sometimes mechanical forms of explanation in social contexts or mechanisms, mechanical systems as an analogy for some social phenomena, in particular market economy and civil society. But I think this doesn't exclude the possibility that the relevant kinds still are teleological kinds, and then there are perhaps particular aspects about these phenomena which can better be illustrated by the use of mechanical categories. His views about teleological explanations of social and historical phenomena, and also his views about the state as an organism, are directly connected to quite problematic aspects of Hegel's thought. So why take an interest in these aspects of his metaphysics at all? For me, one interest here is the question whether there are thoughts here in Hegel that can be used in the context of a critical social theory. In particular, as we all know, there are many forms of, for example, race and gender-related discrimination, which somehow have managed to persist across major forms of social change. And as we try to combat these forms of discrimination today, it would be useful to know why are they able to persist in this way? What kind of things are these phenomena such that they can have this kind of persisting reality? And one traditional functionalist view says that these are structures which exist because of their usefulness for something else, namely for a social and economic order of white and male domination. So a teleological explanation for such phenomena. And then a form of teleology which does not make reference to people's conscious purposes. However, one major problem with such accounts is that it's not clear how this kind of teleology can be spelled out in metaphysical terms. So here my question is whether Hegel's metaphysics of social kinds could perhaps give us some ideas that would enable us to spell out such functionalist accounts of, for example, racism and gender-related discrimination. So in order to better understand Hegel's metaphysics of social kinds, we first have to look at his account of life and teleology in the science of logic, where he uses biological phenomena as a paradigm. And then we have to look how he wants to apply the concepts that he develops in this context to social phenomena. So here's a three-part distinction from the chapter on life in the science of logic. Hegel distinguishes three dimensions of life, three different processes that characterize the life of organisms. First, the so-called internal process of life, which is a matter of the internal diversification of the organism into organs, where there is a mutual teleological dependence between organs and organism. Second, the external process of life, the interaction of the organism with its environment, for example, through nutrition, which is also purposeful because in this way the organism preserves its life in dealing with the environment. And then third, there's the process of the genus, where the kind is preserved through the reproduction and also the death of the individual organisms. Now, like every other account of teleology, Hegel's account faces the problem of backward causation. How is it possible that a phenomenon X exists because of its beneficial consequences, if not via a representation of these consequences? Jim Quinas has developed what I think is a very elegant interpretation of Hegel's solution to this problem, an interpretation on which Hegel's solution emphasizes the role of the process of the genus within Hegel's analysis of life. If we take an organ A1 of organ type A and an organism B1 of organ of organism type B, then to say that organ A1 of organism B1 exists because of its beneficial consequences for the whole organism can mean that first, organs of kind A in general are beneficial for the survival and reproduction of organisms of kind B. Therefore, ancestral organisms B2, B3, B4, and so on, with equivalent organs A2 and so on, were able to survive and reproduce. And therefore, it is possible for the offspring organism B1 with its organ A1 to exist. So on this interpretation, Hegel solves the problem of backward causation, because the beneficial consequences in question that teleological explanations appeal to are not the beneficial consequences downstream to the explanandum, but past beneficial consequences of equivalent organs in equivalent organisms of the same kind. Now let's move on to Hegel's application of these notions to the social case. And here I will first focus on his analysis of the state as an organism. Here's one important paragraph from The Elements of the Philosophy of Right. The idea of the state has immediate actuality and is the individual state as a self-related organism, the constitution or constitutional law. It passes over into the relationship of the individual state to other states, international law, and it is the universal idea as a genus and as an absolute power in relation to individual states, the spirit which gives itself its actuality in the process of world history. So if we recall Hegel's three-part analysis of biological life, it's quite obvious that he uses this analysis, these three dimensions, in his analysis of the social life of the state. The first element, the constitutional structure of the state, corresponds to the internal process of life, the diversification into different organs. The second dimension, international law, corresponds to the external process of life, the interaction with the environment. And third, the process of the genus, across reproduction and death of individuals, that corresponds to world history. I will now focus on points A and C. Hegel does not say so much about point B, and it's not so important for purposes anyway. The internal process of the life of the state. Hegel understands, based on the biological analogy, the constitution of the state as a kind of diversification into functional parts, which here are institutions. He calls these institutions of the state also organic moments of the whole. He describes in several passages of the Philosophy of Right a kind of social self-preservation of these institutions and of the state across these institutions. And there are several elements here that mirror elements in Hegel's analysis of the internal process of life in general. One element is growth via the creation of new institutions, laws, and so on. Another element is self-regulation, for example, sanctions against illegal behavior. Self-regulation is also an aspect of the internal process of life of organisms, for example. And then also self-renewal. So just as an organism, a biological organism often has to renew parts that have decayed, the social organism also has to renew itself, for example, through education of new generations. Now, one very important point on my view is that while the most natural application of the biological analogy of the organs is within the social sphere and especially the state is the institutions. Hegel sometimes also treats individual citizens of the state as organs of the state. So there are two different ways in which he applies this analogy of organs within the internal process of life. And I think the question whether individual citizens too, in addition to institutions, should count as organs of the state on such an analysis, that question really makes several crucial differences for the kind of social metaphysics that one ends up with. One difference is the following. If citizens count as organs, then given the teleological mutual relation between the organism and its organs. The state understood as organism is a functional state, a well-working teleological system, only if it benefits and protects its citizens qua organs. The whole organism has to be purposeful with regard to the organs and vice versa. So then one gets the consequence that a properly organic state, teleologically functional state, is automatically a just state, which grants rights to its citizens, which protects the rights of the citizens, and so on. Otherwise, the state would lack organic structure. It would not be a teleological, well-working organism. But if one counts only institutions as organs, then one does not get this implication. So then one can, for example, imagine the possibility that we have a totalitarian system which uses a lot of things like propaganda and indoctrination and so on, and does so in a very successful way, successful by its own standards. So this system manages through these institutions to preserve itself. We can imagine that it displays a high degree of social and historical stability if the institutions are well designed with regard to the purpose of this kind of system, while at the same time these kinds of institutions and the whole system is bad for most of the individuals. So we have here two quite different perspectives that one can take on this idea of the state as an organism. Hegel's perspective seems to be the first one, as there are some passages where he does treat the individual citizens as organs of the state. This approach fits well a normative project where Hegel can use considerations about institutional design and institutional functionality within the project that wants to find out what the structure of a just state is, and which therefore has normative consequences for politics and also for our individual behavior. So in this case, we can identify a well-working functional stable state with a just state, and find out about the nature of a just state by looking at the functional structure of a state where also the citizens count as organs. If we take the second approach by contrast, we get an understanding of the state as organism which is congenial to critical projects. For then we can develop a metaphysical interpretation of forms of states and social phenomena more generally in terms of organic teleological structures, where also, for example, totalitarian states can be analyzed in these terms. And we can precisely use such terms in order to understand how such states can be so successful in the sense that they bring about institutions which enable this kind of system to persist and to preserve itself. A second important difference regarding to this question whether relating to this question whether individual citizens should count as organs is the following. In the biological case, it seems plausible to say that there's a kind of priority of the whole over the parts, despite the mutual relation. There's also a kind of precedence that the whole takes, because the survival of the whole organism is in a way more important than the survival of the particular organs. Why? Because it can be a good idea for the organism to sacrifice one of its organs if that is required in order to be able to survive. That's much better than if the whole organism dies in an attempt to rescue one organ. If you take this aspect of the biological case and apply this to the social case, and then count citizens as organs of the state, as Hegel sometimes does, then we get the consequence that the state takes precedence over citizens, and then it becomes very understandable why Hegel describes the state, for example, as absolute and unmoved and in itself. And there are many further passages where he describes this kind of priority of the whole over the individual citizens. By contrast, if only institutions are organs, there is not this implication of so much about the internal process of life, the diversification into functional elements of the individual state. As I said, I will skip the external process of life and now directly go to the process of the genus. And here, Hegel tells us more in his lectures on the philosophy of history about how he understands this dimension of social life. Here he explains us that history consists of a sequence of periods where in each period there's one national spirit that has a dominating role and that expresses itself in a state that is vanguard in this period. And then this state and the culture that is connected to it dies at some point, and the vanguard position is transferred to some other natural spirit in another part of the world, which then expresses itself in the most modern form of state in that period. And he organizes his whole theory of the philosophy of history in this way, and we get a narrative that begins with and in China and then moves across India, Persia, Greece, and Rome to the Germanic or European states. And then there are some hints at the possibility that America may be the natural spirit and vanguard state, at least some American state, the vanguard state of the future. This picture gives us an application of the biological idea of a process of the genus, because we get here a sequence of individual instances that preserve the whole genus state across history, just as we get different biological organisms that preserve across generational change their biological kind. There are various problems with this account of history. Quite obviously, one huge problem is that it is an explicitly racist account and a Eurocentric account. Africa is excluded from this whole narrative because of racist motivations that Hegel is very explicit about. This kind of narrative implies that European states have a kind of superiority over and against the other states and their national spirits. In addition, there's a structural problem here regarding the question whether Hegel really can use these biological analogies in a social metaphysics. And the problem here is that it is not clear what the social analog of reproduction is. So remember that reproduction played a crucial role in Hegel's solution to the problem of backward causation. The biological story is tied to the idea that there is reproduction and also inheritance across reproduction, so that we get biological kind which preserves itself across generations. And how does that work in the social sphere? How can there be a social analog of reproduction? Now, there is something like a social analog of reproduction, namely social inheritance across generations or across groups by mechanisms like learning or imitation and formation of traditions. But importantly, such mechanisms don't have the same metaphysical role as biological reproduction in the biological case. For one thing, it's possible that instances of the same social kind can emerge without being connected through social inheritance. And that's not possible in the biological case. So in the social case, it's possible that, for example, democracies emerge at different places and different points of history without there being any causal connection between the two token democracies. And still, they can count as instances of the same social kind. In addition, in the cases where social inheritance takes place, this can happen also without beneficial consequences of that which is inherited. for the possibility of reproduction and preservation of the organism and the genus. It's simply possible that societies, for example, or groups at a given point imitate the behavior and structure of other earlier groups, independently of whether that structure actually was beneficial for that other group. And that means that this solution for the problem of backward causation, and hence the whole explanation of biological teleology that we looked at earlier, cannot be applied to social phenomena after all. So where does that leave us? I would like to explore the possibility of rescuing, in a way, Hegel's attempt to model a social metaphysics on the metaphysics of biological organisms by modifying the biological analogy, the fixed end of the biological analogy, with, as I said, the motivation of getting here tools for critical social theory. If we take as explanandum the fact that Tiger Hobbs has stripes at time t, then one form of teleological explanation that we can give here is Quirinus' Hegel-style explanation, where we explain the fact that Hobbs has stripes at time t by reference to past benefits that stripes had for the self-preservation and reproduction of ancestral tigers. But then we can also formulate another kind of teleological explanation here, which explains Hobbes's stripes at time t by reference to past benefits that stripes had for Hobbes's self-preservation prior to time t. So here we don't look at earlier organisms of the same biological kind, we look at earlier stages of Hobbes and the benefits that stripes, either the numerically same stripes or at least stripes of the same feature kind, had for Hobbes these earlier stages, and made it possible that Hobbes survived and exists now with his stripes. Both forms of explanation are compatible with each other. They can they single out different causal contributions to the actual existence of the stripes at t. But importantly, proximal teleological explanations do not require reproduction or inheritance. So it would seem that this form of explanation can be also applied to social phenomena. So here is a generalized, not specifically biological, formulation of a proximal form of teleological explanation. I would now bother you by reading through all of this. I would just like to point out that I would suggest that this form of explanation is apt to spell out in metaphysical terms functional explanations for the persistence of social phenomena, as opposed to their causal origin that cannot be captured by this form of explanation, but perhaps at least why they manage to persist. For example, phenomena such as racial and gender-based discrimination. So remember this functionalist idea that they exist because of their usefulness for the preservation of a system of white male domination. My idea would be that this form of explanation here helps us to spell out the kind of teleology that is involved in this functionalist account. By way of conclusion, I would like to point out that there's a further important difference between these explanations and distal teleological explanations. These ones don't make reference to objective kinds, so we don't get this close connection between teleological explanation and objective kinds as in distal teleological explanations on Hegel's and Quirinus' account. However, I would also like to suggest that there still can be an important metaphysical connection here between proximal teleological explanations and objective kinds. If a feature of a social system exists because of its usefulness for the preservation of the system, for example, propaganda within a totalitarian regime, then it's at least easily possible that another token institution, for example, another regime under similar circumstances, which faces similar tasks and is constrained by the same human nature, for example, will employ the same feature propaganda because it will be useful for its own preservation too. And then we will have convergent institutions, very similar to totalitarian systems, for example, which share these preservation enabling features. And these token institutions converge on a common form, on a social kind. And precisely the usefulness of this feature for the preservation of such a system, which also the proximal teleological explanation appeals to, that will be the basis for this convergence and for the existence of the objective kind. So in some way, we get a metaphysical connection between kind and teleological explanation in this case too. So that was it. Thanks a lot for your patience if you watched until now. And I look forward to discussion.